This is Josiah Plays Torment, Tides of Numenera. Okay, we are here in the trade post. We just came from the Ascension. We cannot go back the way we came because the portal is gone. Which means we now have to go try to find our way through over here or something. Maybe get this business out of the way. Massive glands.
Go.
So let's mess with the tongue cluster again. And see if we can get something happening here. The bloom tongues make wet, unpleasant sounds as they writhe and squirm against each other. As you approach, the voices of the bloom begin to click and buzz in your ears, making your fingers twitch and setting your teeth on edge. You catch yourself reaching instinctively for the magmatic amulet, as if it's something you've done many times before. I'll listen to the voices again. Even after drinking the water of the bloom, you can't hear the voices clearly. You'll have to make a more direct connection to the tongues. Touch the tongues again. Thrust your hand into the midst of the writhing tongues. They pass through it with a prickly sensation that dances through muscle and bone. The water of the bloom attunes your senses to the subtle vibrations of the tongues. Their roots extend throughout the chamber, wriggling beneath the bloom flesh. Let's touch the magmatic amulet. You grasp the crystalline artifact. At once, the voices of the bloom grow louder, and louder still. They fill your consciousness, drowning out your thoughts, hissing and whispering and chittering and buzzing. They're coming from every direction, from above and below, from nearby and far away. Swaying on your feet, you nearly topple to the floor. Matkina grabs hold of your arm to prevent you from falling. What's wrong with you? Her eyes are wide and confused. You shake your head, unable to respond, caught up in the torrent of maddening sound. Slowly, the bloom voices resolve themselves into their constituent parts, but now they carry sense impressions with them. Hunger, curiosity, desire. Each burst of bloom voices evokes a new impression in your mind. For a moment, you let go of the amulet, and the sense impressions are gone. The voices are nothing but meaningless babble. Then you touch the amulet again, and the sense impressions return. You realize that the magmatic amulet is a translator of sorts, though the limits and scope of its power are uncertain. Interesting. Let's listen to the nearest voices. You hear the cluster of bloom tongues whispering softly to you, exuding a sense of expectation and familiarity. These tongues know your scent, or perhaps that of your sire, and they are eager to touch your mind. But their voices are not the only ones here. A score of other voices gibber and shout from the dark corners of the room. Ordinary human voices that once belonged to the merchants, guards, and bloom guides who were devoured here. Fragments of their minds cling to life in their half-digested corpses, and they cry out in confusion, rage, or pain. Listen to the nearest voices again. The bloom tongues whisper softly to you, tickling the edges of your consciousness like tiny wriggling fingers, trying to reach inside your mind. Every few moments, the whispering tongues are drowned out by the voices of the men and women who were devoured in this chamber. They shriek in confusion and anguish, unaware that they are already dead. Let's listen to the distant voices. You focus on the bloom voices that are coming from outside the trade post. What seemed at first like an indistinct babble is actually many different voices. Thousands of voices, each arising from somewhere else in the bloom. Some of the voices belong to individual maws, evoking impressions of hunger and need. Others resonate from deeper places within the bloom. When you concentrate on those voices, you experience flashes of intense emotion, or catch fleeting glimpses of men and women being beaten or killed. Every voice is unique, chittering, groaning, barking, whispering, rattling, hissing, yet all of them are the bloom. Let's listen to the distant voices again. Concentrate on the voices that echo from the far, festering corners of the bloom. Some belong to maws, chittering their particular desires, while others arise from deeper places. Let's try to communicate with the cluster of bloom tongues. Relaxing your mind, you allow the whispering of the bloom tongues to penetrate your thoughts. Memories rise into your consciousness, trivial moments you thought you had forgotten. Just as you recognize them, they are swept away. The bloom tongues are sifting through your memories, looking for something. The voices dig deeper into your unconscious. What seemed harmless at first becomes irritating. A dull ache blossoms in the back of your head, spreading across your skull and down your spine. The pain comes in waves, as if the bloom is trying to wrench a memory out of your brain. I can use the tidal surge to calm this shit the fuck down, or I can allow it to feed on my memory. I think I'm going to allow it. I took some damage. Dimly, you are aware of the bloom's presence in your mind, pulling at a memory hidden deep in your unconscious, like a stubborn tooth that refuses to be torn out. With a final gout of searing agony, the memory bursts into your conscious mind. You stand under a blazing purple sun that was never of the ninth world you know. Your body sits heavy on you, unfamiliar muscles rippling as you move. And move you must. As your boots lose their propulsive power, you must scramble at the sheer rock face for the extra boost, pulling yourself up with your battered hands, trying to reach the eye socket of the mountain-sized statue. You laugh madly, and you can feel your consciousness straining to leave this shell. You gain the safety of the carven eye. You look below to see your pursuers swarming up the cliff. You are defiling their holy ground, and they mean to make you pay in blood. Their lamprey mouths, their many arms, and the needle-capped suckers on their hands all suggest that they're more than capable of taking it. Except as they come, you hold your hand out above them and curl it into a fist. The air coalesces into an acid shower that rains down among them. Their screams are like an opera. Wow. The memory ends, slurped from your mind like sugary nectar. You remember witnessing it, yet the memory itself, the collection of sensory impressions that was actually experienced by the changing god, is gone, devoured by the bloom. The bloom tongues sag drunkenly against each other, as if the feast has made them languid and confused. Alright, let's try to use our intellect to take control of the bloom tongues. 100% because I'm an intellect god. You reach across the barrier that separates your consciousness from that of the tongues, a barrier now made permeable by the amulet. Tentatively, you begin to direct the motions of the tongues. It's a strange sensation, like having another set of limbs, but they respond to your impulses. Belatedly, the tongues try to resist, but with a bit of concentration, you quiet them like errant thoughts. These tongues, you realize, are a tiny locus of the bloom's consciousness. Their roots extend throughout the trade post, and now so do your thoughts and commands. Hmm. I'm gonna release the human minds that are trapped in the trade post. A few moments of concentration reveal that the snaking roots of the bloom tongues are still connected to the corpses. Hair-like fibers grow through the putrefying flesh, linking to their half-dead brains, keeping their minds alive. You force the bloom tongues to withdraw their fibers from each of the bodies. One by one, the gibbering voices cease, and their tortured minds fade and die. Let's move the trade post back to its original location. You close your eyes and relax your mind, probing the limits of your new senses. The roots of the bloom tongues run throughout the trade post, but they also extend some distance into the surrounding flesh. A few of them trail upward, tracing a path toward an open cavity in the outer reaches of the bloom. Steeling yourself, you take hold of all the tendrils at once, urging them back along that path, clawing their way toward the surface and dragging the trade post after them. The ground buckles and churns beneath your feet, and the whole chamber begins to move. At last, you open your eyes and the shaking subsides. The blocked archway is opening. You hear astonished voices outside. Hey, alright! Their energy spent, the bloom tongues recede into the ground. Alright, handled that. Handled it. Navigational cortex. Perhaps you'd rather have the cortex than the amulet. Okay. Here we go. Out of the trade post and back down to... This should lead to the vast interior, yes. These merchants are going to be really surprised. Why can't I? Back to the vast interior. Ioxu's nasty Sligan house. As you emerge from the trade post, you hear sharp intakes of breath. The two merchants you met earlier are staring at you in amazement. That great jaw and the teeth, they're gone! Portly human beams at you. Was this your doing? If it was, you have our deepest thanks.
Indeed, the Vargellan ducks its head. Pray the waits us in the Ascension place. We should go.
Yes, yes, human nudges his friend. But it's still damned impressive, eh? I thought the bloom only answered to the Memavira. Where is she when we need help? Hiding in her fortress, that's where.
Now let's talk to Grissler again. Grissler squints at you.
You spoke to her, didn't you? To the bloom, I mean. And she listened.
That troubles you.
Doesn't trouble me so much, but it might trouble some. I can find my way just about anywhere in this great big sack of piss and corruption, and I say that out of love. But even I can't reshape the bloom. Guess I'd be careful about using that kind of power if I was you. Folks in charge might mistake you for a threat. Happens a lot around here, and I'd hate to see it happen to you.
He shrugs and the lopsided grin returns.
Ah, what can I do for you? I know all about the bloom and her moths.
Eh well.
We're packing up for the Ascension, friend. We'll see you in the trade post when we return.
We're packing up for the... Oh, it says the same thing. Okay.
Welp. Looks like we're in a good position to sell a few things, I guess.
Yes.
Sunderman and Sunderman and Sunderman. I have so much money.
Sure.
So much.
On it.
So it's time to go back and talk to Dracogen.
Let's go.
And see what we can work out with him.
Well, Castoff, what news have you? Have you managed to obtain the cortex, or are you ready to surrender the amulet?
Would you accept the cortex that we discussed earlier in place of the amulet?
I'll remember that.
Ah, yes, that would indeed be sufficient. Should you manage to obtain it, it would certainly be a fine substitution for the amulet. But I have doubts. I've tried and failed to acquire it before.
Making a note.
The agents I employed previously were not up to the task. This was an occasion of great surprise to me. They were tough, capable explorers, and I thought them more than sufficient to the job. To gain access to the anchorage and the cortex, I suggest that you employ guile before violence. I would hate to see you fail as they did.
I'd like to ask a few more questions. Let's talk about returning the amulet. I don't know that I want to give him the amulet. Maybe, perhaps. Farewell.
Okay. So Covetous Hearts wants me to retrieve the navigational cortex from the anchorage. Hashtag, I had a quest.
Dracogen is definitely interested in obtaining the cortex, and he admitted to sending a team to steal it, but they were slain in the attempt. If I try to acquire the cortex for him, he recommends that I rely on guile and deception, not force. I've learned that outsiders aren't allowed to access the navigational cortex.
On it.
Well, let's go back to the Lascars and see what we can see.
Go. Something I could do.
Yes.
Back to the anchorage. The anchorage.
Want it done right.
you're sure it's safe.
Oh, I'm sure it's safe.
Yes, now.
I was hoping I'd see the other ones here. Arechian crew. But I don't see them. Oh, Arechi is here! And there are more Lascars here than they were before. So they have returned. Maybe Captain Janner will be really grateful to me. So, you come to me with questions in your eyes. Ask, and I will answer if I can. Why can't I visit the Cortex again? Yeah, that's what she said last time. Okay. Lascar.
Doing it.
Lascar of the Mohicans. Not so many visitors come from Bloom. Welcome. We is, no, are. We are home. You thanks from us. Alkai numados visti, kalevai.
On it.
Okay. Let's talk to Arechi here.
Opener of ways, we have regained the anchorage. This one thanks you. Though the anchorage is not home, it is home to us. Much work to do here yet.
Alright.
Gets do it. Or is it the other way?
Let's talk to Pilot Major Genji's again. Donate doors to firmly shut. Right. Okay. Nervous at this point. Let's try talking to Pilot Major Genji's again.
How is it I can serve?
I'd like that tour you offered.
Now, Genji says, looking alarmed. Would be happy to, but many tasks.
He flushes as his grasp of your language abandons him in his embarrassment.
Not now, he mumbles, looking away. But soon? Very soon. Please return later.
You have time to give me that tour you offered yet? He flushes.
Apologies, but still not. I'm awaiting crucial messages. But soon, I promise.
What? Seriously? Well, what do I do then?
Yes.
The multiple well-polished locks line the edges. You can't help noticing that this door isn't quite as thick as the others you've seen here. And a soft, buzzing hum rises from within it. A complex control panel, or possibly another lock, is in the wall beside the door. The buttons are marked with symbols you don't understand, and the light behind them flickers like a candle.
Making a note.
Do not touch the door, please. The Cortex chamber is not for outworlders. Apologies.
We won't be getting in there so long as he's around. Mackina mutters. We have to distract him somehow. Tour. Oh! Now he has time for the tour! Alright! Yes, he says, smiling wildly.
My thanks for patience and apologies for delay. Follow me. You have already seen the elevator room. You will now see the observation deck, where we watch for the coming ship, where we study the path of the stars. Follow, please.
Crisis initiated. Wait, Cape Genji's occupied with the tour. Access the cortex room. First, see this. The paths between stars. The journeys that took us to this place. And please, ask questions if you have questions.
We should take him up on that, Matt Kina mutters. The longer we keep talking, the more time we have to find the cortex.
Alright, so last cast off is gonna talk to the pilot major.
Any questions have you before we continue?
Do you have names for any of these stars?
Some, yes, he shrugs. Others, no. Much has been lost.
He gestures you along, urging you to follow him. Alright. I don't know what we're gonna do about that.
It's beautiful.
Yes, he agrees. I think so also.
Gestures you along, urging you to follow him. Alright. I'm hoping that Matt Kina can handle the door.
So, studying this display can help your people find their way home?
He blinks rapidly, surprised by your question.
Some of us believe this. They come here when they have no work to stare at the changing paths. To draw their own maps and... dream. Yes, dream.
Pauses, gathering his thoughts. Alright, Makina is gonna bounce. She can't hide, apparently. But she could just run in here, right?
Consider it done.
Oh, of course it doesn't use quick fingers. The ancient door is locked tight. The control panel beside it flickers with a sizzling sound. Of course it doesn't use quick fingers. I changed my mind. Oh god, this has turned into a disaster! Now, she can't. He stares into the changing stars, his eyes are filled with their light.
I believe that the paths between the stars are too many. That we must wait for the ship.
He sighs deeply.
We must move along now.
Alright, you know what? Last cast off. Come in here and handle this.
Yes, now. Let's go.
She doesn't have an action. Fine. Alright, Ren, talk to him.
Apologies, I do not have much time. Should keep moving if you want to see everything.
Alright, well in that case, we'll just stand here. but he's going to the next spot.
Now, see this. A map of another kind. A living painting of the Cortex's thoughts.
Now, I can pop this door. With machinery lore. 100%. Tap the symbols at random, noticing that the light behind them goes out when you hit certain buttons in sequence. Clicks and mechanical snaps sound within the door as you work, glancing back occasionally to be sure you haven't been discovered. With no warning, the door opens. With a sizzling pop, the panel goes utterly dark, and you smell burning wires. You won't be closing this door again, it seems. Alright, go on in. Ooh, look at that thing. That's fucking awesome looking. Alright, Ren. Keep talking to hometown here. I will explain what I can if you have questions. It refreshes constantly. Wait, we're talking about Ren.
It refreshes constantly. Is it changing its mind? We're checking if the thoughts are still there.
The light blooms across your guide's face.
I wondered the same thing.
He looks at the air, lips moving, composing his response. You can come talk to him as well.
A moment, please. If you talk now, I will forget my thinking.
I don't think Makina really needs to come in here and do anything. You can't read the text on this display, but the graphics seem to depict atmospheric conditions and power levels in the room. It's just a monitoring station. Nothing can be controlled from here. Waves of coherent thought radiate from the orb, flooding your mind with strange abstract calculations and mathematical formulae. It shines so brightly that you can't look at it for long. Let's see what happens if I mess with this. The sphere turns slowly, almost thoughtfully. The glow of the control console pulses with it, warming the palms of your hands. You touch the console and the warmth spreads up your arms and into your mind. At the moment of contact, a female voice speaks. Ah, the city, didn't it? And with a brief stutter, it continues in the truth. Would you like to do? Glance around, seeking the source of the voice, before you realize that it is speaking only in your head and to you alone. There's a lot of things I can ask it. I'm gonna ask the Cortex about itself.
I am a navigational cortex. I was manufactured 3,059 cycles ago by the Devabil Combine, with 2,153 cycles remaining. I was brought here through a localized dimensional vortex, which has since collapsed. I am powered by a quantum-tunneled interstitial hoverine matrix, the glowing orb you see before you. I interact with both users and appropriate receptacles to provide observed and recorded historical information, starfield tracking and navigation, observation, and essential starport maintenance. I maintain information regarding exactly 1,097,544 star systems, with detailed information on routes between them, including known transdimensional passages. For every world in each of these star systems, I hold detailed images of their night skies and projected daytime star fields. Additionally, I maintain detailed personnel information for this station, dating back many centuries.
Let's examine the station's personnel history. Thousands of records, perhaps tens of thousands, scroll past your eyes, appended with arcane timekeeping, name changes, dates of birth and death. All the personnel who have ever lived, traveled, or otherwise passed through the anchorage, no matter how brief their stay. The sheer amount of information is overwhelming. Sensing your bewilderment, the smooth voice says,
"Certain historical trends can be deduced through analysis of this data, but this does not seem to be your focus. Popular interactions include brief historical overviews of the station, important recent events, and location searches on missing crew members."
Let's get a historical overview of the station.
"My records extend over 10,000 of your years, inherited from my predecessor in this position. In all this time, the people now calling themselves the Lascars have crewed this station, and pre-existing records suggest that they were here in a more formal, military-slash-servile capacity before the shipping lanes began to close. The original crew of the station has repopulated the station, and their descendants have grown in number. A number of conflicts have arisen over the years, in particular the five-cycle mutiny, the airlock debacle, and the castaway action. Each of these helped define the current power and familiar structure of the existing population. The current structure of the population is strongly based on and influenced by the naval hierarchy of their forebears. They await the coming of another ship to close the station properly and bring them home."
Let's request information on recent occurrences.
"Approximately 15 years ago, as you measure time, a transdimensional pathway opened to the station. This was the first contact with other sentient life the inhabitants of this station have had in generations. Trade was established. That portal closed recently, but it has been replaced with the pathway through which you entered."
How about further information on recent occurrences? Okay, she just... Alright. Review the records for missing personnel.
"A single Lascar remains unaccounted for." That's the one with the helmet that got murdered. "Jemadar Achili passed through the dimensional gateway approximately..."
The voice pauses as if calculating.
"15 years of your time ago. She has not returned."
Okay, stop. Hold on. This thing is some kind of amazing supercomputer that can navigate spaceships through fucking all of the universe and shit, but it has to stop to calculate 15 years? Really? I mean, I might have to stop to add up some years to figure out 15 years, but I mean, this computer should be able to do that in like a billionth of a second.
"If you have any information on additional personnel not covered by this census, please report immediately to the captain."
Hey, Nox, good to see ya. Woo. How's it going, Nox? No work team is today, right? Alright, let's ask about the history of the station again. That's the missing personnel again. Let's ask for more information about the missing Jemadar Achili.
"Jemadar Achili traveled through the transdimensional portal that opened 15 years ago. Her mission was to explore and establish potential embassy and trade. She was also to seek other routes whereby the inhabitants of this station might find passage to their home world. Her last transmission contained a report of her investigation of a community known as the Bloom, which apparently existed inside a living creature. She was 28 years of age when she departed. She left behind two sisters, a brother, and a father."
Ask about her again. It's identical. I'm doing pretty good, Nox. Pretty good. Not too bad today. I had to go to the pharmacy and the grocery store earlier, a little bit earlier, and I hate going to the store so much. So I'm recovering from the psychic strain of going to the store. But I'll be okay. Review something else. I await your command. Let's ask the cortex about itself again. Okay, it says exactly the same thing. Let's ask for information on the helmet found in the bloom.
This helm belongs to the Jemadar Achille. She has been missing for 15 years by the reckoning of your world. It contains a visual record she marked as being of importance. She suggested these images be analyzed. I will do so on your command.
We'll come back to that. Let's request the exact location of the anchorage. The smooth voice says,
the exact coordinates of this station are 12.93476.947, 18 hours, 57 Z.
Seconds? Seconds? Is that even hours? I don't know. 18H, 57 Z. These numbers also helpfully appear in the pale blue light of the control console. Nox says 10 psychic damage from shopping. Exactly. The store got me with a terrifying move, Nox. It was unfortunate. You suspect that if you had the proper education and context to understand these numbers, you might have a better picture of your location. As it is, they mean nothing to you. How long have the Alaskars been waiting for the ship?
Assessing records. Calculating. The Lascars have been waiting for the vessel to take them home for approximately 10,091 of your years.
Tell me about the home planet of the Lascars. A bluish globe seen from a great distance, around which many smaller orbs rotate, appears before your eyes as if it were floating in front of you.
The home of the Lascars is called Ishtrinu.
Alright, so it's just the helmet now. To analyze that on the helmet.
I'll remember that.
Processing. One moment. Biological matter has entered some of the helmet's contacts. I will be unable to analyze this object unless the cortex removal process has progressed to the third stage. This will allow me to open the cortex housing and perform a focus scan analysis of the helmet.
I see. Alright, let's start the cortex removal process.
Of course. As I note that you are a first-time user, Stage 1 requires you to assemble a pass symbol on the screen before you and pull the lever on the side of the console.
A jumble of small, jagged symbols tumble across the screen as if tossed there by a careless hand. What if I complain that the process is too complicated?
Removal of the cortex is a significant action with potentially hazardous consequences for the anchorage, the voice says pleasantly. As such, the designers of my mind decided that the removal procedure should be undertaken by a user capable of rational thought under pressure. The voice pauses. To put it more simply, you must complete a series of tests in order to gain access to the cortex. I apologize for any inconvenience this may cause you.
Alright, let's ask for information about Stage 1.
The first stage randomly generates a pass symbol, comprised of 9 to 17 shapes that must be aligned within a short period of time. The lever on the side of the console can only be pulled when these shapes are aligned.
The voice pauses for a moment. When it speaks again, you detect a hint of eagerness.
I have not seen a U user attempt this stage for some time. Pilot Major Genjis has become quite proficient at this process. Good luck, new user.
Okay. So now he's still giving us the tour. So we're in the middle of a crisis here, Nox, where we're trying to break into this thing and steal this cortex without having to fight all these Lascars. So we've got this guy giving a couple of our characters a tour, and we have to try to keep him busy as long as possible while we do all the stuff we have to do in the other room. Genji reaches into the display, spreading his fingers. One of the threads curls around his wrist.
I try to follow this Herekra. How to say, thought example? To question every thought, yes? to have a flexible mind.
He reluctantly removes his hand.
The tour must continue. I have much to finish after.
Alright, last cast off. Can start the process on this thing.
I'm going.
Voice of the Cortex speaks to you, filling your mind. Okay, let's continue the Cortex removal process. Alright, we're gonna use machinery lore. Yank the lever down without assembling the shapes. No, we're gonna use machinery lore. Oh, it's based on... Wait a minute, did I pick the right one? How the hell is this not based on... intellect? Based on speed? It's fucking weird. Alright. No, I failed with 90! Oh, come on! You poke at the small jagged symbols ineffectually, but can't make sense of how to fit them together.
Disengagement time limit has passed, the voice says at last. Stage one has reset.
No, alright, Ren, keep this guy talking. Oh, we don't have much time. Should keep moving if you want to see everything, huh? Alright, so she can't really do anything at the moment. And neither can he, because he won't talk to us again. Alright. Well, she's got great speed, so she should be able to handle this. Try to reassemble the past symbol again. 100%. Working swiftly, you compose the small, jagged shapes into a larger, unfamiliar symbol with a series of satisfying clicks. You attempt to operate the device unsuccessfully, and an intellect devourer is summoned and omnoms you. Yeah. It's an utter debacle. Plunk sounds in lever's housing. And you pull it down.
An excellent solution.
As I yawn a bunch, the voice says warmly.
Well done.
The hum beneath the voice changes subtly.
Stage one of the removal process has been completed. Your actions must now be verified from the control pit. Please wait.
Uh-oh. Oh, we have to confirm the unlock command on the control panel in the observation deck. Who's even gonna do that?
Once your actions in stage one have been verified, we will proceed to stage two. Each stage must be verified by a control pit operative in the observation deck. Once they signal their approval of your actions during this stage, the process can proceed.
Okay, so I'm gonna use Rin. Hopefully she can go stealth and go over there and use the panel in the middle without being noticed. These two will stay here to work on this thing, and Allegern will stay with the tour guide to keep asking him questions. Hopefully that will take care of our business. Last cast-off's turn. Oh, she can't do anything until after Rin's turn. Damn! There's no way to, like, delay your turn, either. You just end your turn, or, you know, whatever. You just skip your turn, basically. There's no way to say, hey, I'd like to just wait a second and act after Rin. Nope. Alright, now, Rin, this is really important. Really gonna need you to not fuck this up. Really gonna need you to not fuck this up. Why can't she hide? Oh, do we have to talk to him, or do we have to use the panel? I don't know what to do.
You can do this.
Oh, so you do use stealth and quick fingers. Too bad we don't have Matt Kina over here. Clean the screen on the console is displaying an angular symbol composed of many tiny pieces. A button is flashing beside it. He doesn't have an action left to do any of this. Alright, Allegern, come talk to this guy. Oh, Allegern can't even keep up with them! Shit.
Done.
This isn't going well. I have the wrong people assigned to the wrong tasks here. She can't do anything yet. Again, she's just gonna have to waste her whole turn because we're waiting on Rin. Now see, he trails off and chuckles. You know this door, of course. You came to us from it. Allengern's not even gonna be able to get to him to talk to him. Oh, this is not going well. Again, last cast off is gonna have to waste another turn doing nothing. Because we're still waiting on Rin. Oh, this is horrible. Okay.
Doing begets learning, I guess.
Press the stage one button while the last car is not looking. Oh, she's got 100%. Alright, good job. Good job, Rin. Wait until the last car is preoccupied and swiftly tap the button. Alaskar looks over at the sound, at your innocent face, and then the now dark screen and button. He frowns. Okay, that's good, Rin. Allegern, can we please come talk to this guy? Oh, and I don't have an action to ask him a question to get him to stop here. Fuck. Have you any questions of the door to your home? He chuckles, clearly expecting none. Actually, one moment, please. I have to do something. This isn't going well. We're having major problems here.
One moment, and it's done.
Continue the cortex removal process. Stage 2 initialized. Please identify the core locking components from the previous stage. Once you have done so, the casing over the error, unable to translate title of switch. Switch will open. Flip the switch to complete the stage. Let's ask about the error. You hear a series of clicks in your head. Apologies, a separate intelligence is responsible for error reporting. I am not aware of any errors at this time. Please proceed with the actions required for stage 2. Let's try to do number 3 here. She's got 100%. Oh, no, she doesn't. Fuck. I'm not going to waste all her pool for this. I'm just going to let Last Cast Off do this. Let's request information.
This stage requires either a high degree of visual retention or the ability to identify the smaller parts of a greater whole. Namely, you will need to identify 6 parts of the shape you assembled in stage 1 from a number of incorrect symbols.
A thread of static whips through the voice in your head.
Selecting 4 incorrect symbols, or allowing the given time to elapse, will reset the stage. Good luck, user.
Good. Off he goes like a fucking maniac. You know, when you're giving a tour, maybe you don't need to sprint from place to place like a crazy person. We're not gonna get this done in time. Just tell it that it's the leaf passage. The what?
On it.
Alright, continue the process. There's so much yawning going on here. 100%. A flood of symbols streams across the console's tiny screen. At first, none of them look in any way familiar, but as you watch, you recognize a few. They disappear beneath your tapping fingertips with sweet, piping pings. A fluttering sound, something like an insect's wings, rises from the console, and the casing pops open. You flick the switch.
Stage 2 complete, the voice says with real pleasure. Well done. Your actions in Stage 2 have been sent to the observation deck to be verified. Please wait.
Okay, now Rin can do the next part, like right now.
Of course.
Quick fingers and stealth. On the monitor, six sigils whirl about each other in a dizzying spiral. A button blinks urgently beside it. Stage 2 button, 100%. Rin's getting it done like a boss. Laskar glances up, eyes leaving the monitor. Swift and silent as air, you lean over and press the button. Laskar looks back down at the click, frowning again.
Butch?
He says sternly. You do not respond, and after a moment, he returns to his work, eyeing you more often now. Alright, so next time is going to be harder, in other words. Good job, Rin. Allegern, can we please... Oh my god, he can't keep up with them! Which means by the time he gets to him the next time, he's not going to be able to...
It's a plan.
He's not going to be able to ask him a question because he's not going to have a fucking action. Continue.
Stage 3 initialized. Simply arrange the previously selected symbols into a critical error. Existing syntax is inadequate, the voice says in high, pleading tones. Instructions are flawed. User may be unable to complete cortex removal procedure. Maintenance is requested. Repeat, maintenance is requested.
After a long pause, the voice resumes, utterly calm.
Once this is complete, manually pull the locking cylinder from its housing, rotate it, and insert it back into the console.
Let's warn the cortex that its instructions were full of errors and missing information. You smell. No. You think you smell burning plastic, molten metal. Then the voice speaks.
I am not aware of any errors, it whispers hoarsely. Complete the stage to the best of your ability. If you are unable to do so, I will not be able to release the cortex as requested. My apologies.
The whispers fall silent. Okay, so this thing is fucking falling apart, which is great. Alright. In our next episode, we will finish this crisis, steal this cortex, and get the fuck up out of here. That's gonna do it for this one. If you're watching the stream, don't go anywhere, because I'm not done playing. If you're watching on YouTube, thanks for watching. This has been Josiah Plays Torment, Tides of Numenera.